Jesus, draw me ever nearer as I labor through the storm you have called me.
Good morning and welcome to our service of morning worship on Sunday the 21st of June. A special welcome this morning to any dads out there. This being Father's Day, we give thanks to God for all the men who act and have acted as role models and father figures of whatever kind in our lives. Let's sing our first hymn now. As we move to our prayers, you may want to follow the service sheet. If you haven't already got a copy, you'll find the link for that on the front page of the website. We meet in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. As God's people, we come from far and wide, a part and yet part of the whole, in isolation and in communion, near and far, we feel his presence with us now. We will worship him together. Loving God, we have come to worship you. Help us to pray to you in faith, to sing your praise with gratitude, and to listen to your word with eagerness. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now we take the opportunity through our prayers to say sorry to God for those things that we really wish had gone very differently. We come to God as one from whom no secrets are hidden, to ask for his forgiveness and peace. Lord God, our Maker and our Redeemer, this is your world and we are your people. Come among us and save us. We have willfully misused your gifts of creation. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have seen the ill treatment of others and have not gone to their aid. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have condoned evil and dishonesty and failed to strive for justice. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have heard the good news of Christ, but have failed to share it with others. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have not loved you with our whole heart, nor our neighbours as ourselves. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. May the God of love and power forgive us and free us from our sins, heal and strengthen us by his Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. The special prayer for the second Sunday after Trinity, the additional collect. Faithful Creator, whose mercy never fails, deepen our faithfulness to you and to your living word, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We're going to listen to our first Bible reading now.
The first reading is from Romans chapter 6, beginning to read at verse 1. Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is free from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let's sing our second hymn together.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still waters. His goodness restores my soul. And I will trust in you. And I will trust in you alone. For your endless mercy follows me. Your goodness will lead. Guides my ways in righteousness, and he anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on his pure delights, and I will try.
Our second Bible reading this morning is brought to us by Anne Green on Delamere Park.
The second reading is from Matthew chapter 10, beginning to read at verse 24. A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher, and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those in his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both body and soul in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs on your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I also will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I also will deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you to both of our readers this morning. And now our Associate Minister Hilary is going to give us a talk in response to those readings.
With today being Father's Day, our reading from Matthew may seem a bit of a strange choice. This is one of those difficult readings that we wish wasn't in the Bible, let alone set as a lectionary reading, especially on Father's Day. A couple of weeks ago, I spoke about triangles not being a good representation for the Trinity. Well, today I'm back on triangles, but this time I'm talking about love triangles. Love triangles are often the subject of film plots, and sometimes they are the circumstances in which a crime is committed. A bit of Miss Marple or Midsummer Murders, perhaps. They're also part of our lives. The question isn't whether we are in a love triangle, as we are more likely are in several of them. The real question is one of priority, commitment and loyalty. The children are going to demonstrate beautifully what that looks like in a few minutes. In today's reading from Matthew, Jesus holds before us a couple of love triangles. I just want you to imagine now these two triangles. In the first, we have Jesus, us, and our mother and father. The second triangle has Jesus, us, and our children. These are by no means the only love triangles of our lives, as they can involve anyone and anything. Every love triangle confronts us with two questions. What is your most important relationship? Whom do you love the most? Two triangles. Jesus, us and parents. Jesus, us and our children. Thinking about the reading, it's not hard to figure out the right answer. Jesus. But what is our lived answer? The answer that's really true. Our lived answer. I would like to think that my lived answer is Jesus. I would like to say with confidence that Jesus is my most important relationship. That he is the one I love most. Love triangles are places of struggle and conflict. Regardless of what I would like to think or say, what does the evidence of my life show? What does the evidence of your life show? What does the ring on my finger and the vows I made to Graham in the sight of God nearly 50 years ago mean? Do I choose Jesus over Graham? How can I do that? Because as hard as it may be, that's what Jesus says I must do. Time-wise, looking at my diary, or where I spend most of my daily hours at the moment, these parishes are my most important relationship. That's where I spend more time than anywhere else. But the parishes and Jesus, however, are not necessarily the same thing. If you were to look at my bank statement, you would say, she's got a thing going with Tesco. That's where she spends all her money. If you knew the thoughts that fill my head and some of the choices I've made, you might conclude that I love myself more than anyone else. And I wouldn't mind betting you know what I'm talking about. We're probably not that different. Our lived answer reveals many different love interests. If, however, Jesus asks us to love him more than our own parents and children, our own flesh and blood, then he also does so with everything else about our lives. There can be only one primary relationship in our lives, and Jesus says it is to be him. His demand for primacy is not limited to our mother and father or our sons and daughters. The list is endless. Whoever loves anyone or anything more than me is not worthy of me, is what he says. This is a big ask. So tell me, where are the love triangles in your life? What is your most important relationship? Whom do you love the most? Today's gospel holds before us and confronts us with many love triangles in which we live and struggle. It demands we make a choice. Does that mean then that we have to reject our parents, our children, our spouses, and all other love interests? Well, I don't think so. I don't think that is what Jesus is saying or asking. Jesus is not demanding exclusivity here, but he is demanding priority. Jesus refuses to be just another one of our many love interests. This refusal to be just another love interest, his demand for priority, is for our own good as well as the good of our love interests. We can only ever have one primary relationship. That one relationship gives us identity and our lives meaning and direction. It becomes the lens through which we see the world, each other and ourselves. It is the foundation on which we build our lives. It guides the choices we make, the words we say, and the ways in which we act and relate. It's a trajectory of our lives and determines how we love. Why then would we want it to be something or someone other than Jesus? God embodied in human life, flesh and blood. So how do we reconcile the right answer, Jesus, with the lived answer of our lives? How do we pick Jesus over our children, our spouse, our parents? How do we look into the faces and say, I love Jesus more? The way I see it, if you love God as your priority, then you give your nearest and dearest the best love you could ever give them. This breaks the triangle. No one is left out, excluded, or rejected. God, not ourselves, becomes the source and origin of our love. This is the love by which we take up the cross and follow Jesus. The same love with which Jesus loves us. We all want to love the best we can, and we know how we can do that because God loved us first. We are able to love because God loves us first, to the extent that he knows every hair on our head. So let us always remember that we love each other best when we love God most. Amen.
Thank you, Hilary. And now we're at that point in our worship that we so very much look forward to, and from all the feedback we're receiving, so do you, when the children show us what they've been doing with the activities that they've received for this week.
I made this jar. The jar represents my life. It has big stones, pebbles, gravelly sand and water in it. The big stones represent God in my life. The pebbles are my family and friends. The gravelly sand is activities like sports, games and TV. And the water is everything else. This is how we made it.
First we put the big stones until it seemed full. Then we added pebbles to fill it more. Is full, right? Then we added the sand, but we had no more, so I'm using sugar. More full.
Say that again.
Now it's even more full. Finally, I managed to fit in water. If I had put the water, sand and pebbles in first, there would be no room for the big stones. In our life, God needs to come first before we get too busy with everything else.
Thank you so much for all your creativity and for all the effort that's gone in behind the scenes to show us what you made of those activities. Thank you too to the adults behind the camera. Let us declare our faith in God. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And now we'll sing our third hymn. Ingleby from Kingsley is going to lead our prayers of intercession this morning.
Almighty God, be with us now, wherever we are, as we seek to come closer to you in our prayers. Open our eyes so that we may see your presence with us more clearly. Open our ears so that we are attuned to your voice and to what you are saying to us. Open our hearts to welcome in your great love for us and your Holy Spirit to guide us. In the midst of all our uncertainties, remind us that you are our rock and our salvation. We will put our trust in you. We thank you, Lord, for your created world. Thank you that many of us have had extra time this year to appreciate the gifts of the natural world around us. Help us all to take care of your world and to share its resources more widely. We especially bring before you now those countries and areas where essential food supplies are destroyed by drought, floods, or insect damage. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you, Lord, for our country, imperfect though it is. And we pray for our government and for all who are in authority nationally and locally. Please guide our leaders in their decision making so that all people are treated fairly and that precious resources are targeted to areas of greatest need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you, Lord, for your church throughout the world. We remember that it was the disciples who first went out with your word for the people around them, and now your church continues that work. We pray for the churches in our villages, not for the buildings, but for the people who are busy working for you in our communities. We pray especially for Hilary, Anne, Audrey, and all those with official roles to carry out. And we ask you to send your Holy Spirit to encourage and direct each one of us as we all play our part in carrying out your plans for our churches here. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you for our families and friends near and far, in or out of our social bubbles. We long to be able to meet them, shake hands or hug them, share a meal with them. But as long as these things remain impossible, we ask you to keep them in the palm of your hand. We especially pray for any who are struggling with loneliness, with worries, with grief for the loss of a loved one. And now, in a few moments, we bring before you those people that we know, people whom you have laid on our hearts at this time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving Lord, in all that comes our way, we will open our hearts to you and believe that all things will work out for our good because we love you. We will not be dragged down by life's challenges. We will pray and know that we are heard. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Jesus taught us to call God our Father. So in faith and trust we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our paths, and a strength to our lives. take us and use us to love and serve in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Great God, you are one God, and you bring together what is scattered and mend what is broken. Unite us with the scattered peoples of the earth, that we may be one family of your children. Bind up all our wounds and heal us in spirit, that we may be renewed as disciples of Jesus Christ, our Master and Saviour. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen. As we come towards the end of our worship, here's a quick reminder about the Zoom coffee meeting. Together, we generally switch on at 11:15 or thereabouts. And if you're watching this on Sunday, the 21st of June in the morning, why not come along and say hello? You'll find the invitation on the front page of the website. And now we'll have our final hymn.
Mine, Lord, with the precious blood.
Together in the final prayer. Jesus, Son of God, let your love shine through our eyes. Your Spirit inspire our words. Your wisdom fill our minds. Your mercy control our hands. Your will capture our hearts. Your joy pervade our being until we are changed into your likeness. From glory to glory. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.